you're doing well. And now, if you don't mind, we're going to get to the news. President Biden traveled yesterday to Nantucket, said one Secret Service agent, "Yes, sir, we've all heard the poem." That's right. President Biden traveled yesterday to Nantucket to spend Thanksgiving with his family because the wishbone is currently his best chance in 2024. President Biden and his family are set to spend Thanksgiving on Nantucket at the $39 million home of private equity billionaire David Rubenstein. Okay, seriously, is anyone at the White House in charge of PR? He won the first election because he was regular old Scranton Joe the train guy who let him have Thanksgiving at a house where the gravy boat is a gravy yacht. According to a new poll, 76% of New York voters believe that Republican Congressman George Santos should resign, while according to him, 147% say he shouldn't. Iowa evangelical leader Bob Vanderplatz yesterday endorsed Florida Governor Ron DeSantis and said that DeSantis has got, quote, the spine to do it, though it's not clear if he meant to be president or to walk in heels. Murder on the spine, I've been told. After pleading guilty yesterday to violating anti-money laundering laws, the cryptocurrency firm Binance is set to pay more than $4 billion in fines. If you're wondering how much that is in crypto, so are they. The Food Network yesterday released a list of the top Thanksgiving recipes in every state, which includes Florida's deep-fried turkey, Nebraska's scalloped corn, and Arkansas's whatever we hit on the drive over. Don't show the face! That's the first rule of critters. Never show the face. According to a new survey, Americans said their second favorite Thanksgiving side dish is stuffing. Their first favorite is the edible they took after their uncle started complaining about pronouns. Authorities in Philadelphia are looking for a team of thieves who allegedly broke into a tractor trailer and stole cases of talcum powder. Of course, if they needed talcum powder that badly, they can't have gotten far. That's Ian's annual joke about chafing. A castle once owned by composer Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart is set to go up for auction. That is so sad. Spotify has got to start paying artists better. And finally, in an effort to combat loneliness, a city in Sweden has launched a new Say Hello campaign that encourages residents to greet each other in public. It's similar to New York's Get the Hell Out of My Way program. That was a monologue, everybody. We are off and running. Got a great show for you tonight. He's one of my favorite actors. His new movie, The Holdovers, is just fantastic. The great Paul Giamatti will be here. He also has a podcast called Chinwag. You guys, this is very exciting. Back in the 90s, I got my start at a comedy theater in Amsterdam called Boom Chicago, co-founded by the authors of Boom Chicago Presents, The 30 Most Important Years in Dutch History. My old friends, Andrew Moskos and Pep Rosenfeld, will be joining us. So excited to talk to them. I'm so happy they're here. Also, I've got some upcoming stand-up dates, including this Sunday in Albany, New York. Come check me out. I'll also be in Santa Fe, New Mexico, Mesa, Arizona, and New Year's Eve, Las Vegas, with my friend John Oliver. Check those out at SethMeyers.com. I'm sorry to do this. Before we move on, there is something that's been bothering me that I need to get off my chest. I was at an important charity gala dinner this morning. How did we miss that all week? And we proofread these things so many times. Literally, the first line of this piece. I was at an important charity gala dinner this morning. When this is over, I'm gonna have a second thing to get off my chest. I was having a great time getting buzzed on fizzy wine when the affair took a turn. An acquaintance of mine soured an otherwise delightful conversation by confiding in me that he was turning 50 soon, and he was scared. He said the best parts of life are over, and he said he regretted all the things he'd never got to do while he was young. Needless to say, I thought his blubbering was a big reeking pile of crap, and lo, I told him so. Clutching his lapels and shaking him like a ragdoll, I shouted, "Stop being a pathetic whiner, and I'm sorry to anyone else feeling weird about their age, but I don't, because here's the bottom line. 50 is the new 20.
At this point in the broadcast, Seth launched into a 60-second obscenity-laden rant about turning 50 and how, in his opinion, it is the new 20. Network policy prevents us from broadcasting his comments, but due to a technical issue, we were forced to air this portion of the show. In short, Seth believes that getting older is a blessing, but he chose to express this sentiment in a series of aggressive and confusing ways. First, he declared he now has more energy than ever because of a very healthy smoothie he makes. He proceeded to pull out a blender and add ingredients. At first, the ingredients were innocuous and reasonable: banana, ginger, and celery. Then came the other stuff. Ethically sourced young blood. Free-range Y chromosomes. A container labeled horse stuff. And for the finishing touch, a secret powder. He rubbed some of this last substance on his gums and said, that's good secret. At this point, Seth polled other men of a certain age on the staff to see if they agreed that 50 is the new 20. Seth's cue card guy, Wally, said, "I think 50 feels like 50. Seth smiled and said, "We don't have to agree on everything." After the show, there was a poison pie in Wally's car. Next, Seth's stage manager, Tom, said, "I think 70 is the new 20. To which Seth initially scoffed, but then Tom did a series of bodybuilding poses that Seth admittedly thought were pretty cool. Seth then asked his head writer, Baze, if he thought 50 was the new 20. "50 is the new 90, wheezed Baze. He then died in his chair. Seth then suggested he's stronger now than he's ever been in his life, and to prove this, he would do 50 push-ups right here and now. He walked in front of his desk and lay flat on the ground, but could not even lift his body one time. On second thought, he said, "I really should get back to hosting the show, but my writer Ben Warheit will continue doing the push-ups for me. Ben, show these people what I'm capable of." Ben, who would do anything for a morsel of paternal approval, dropped to the ground and immediately started blasting out push-ups. At this point, Seth returned to his chair, but instead of walking, he attempted to slide over the desktop like a cool guy from the 80s might slide across the hood of his car. It did not look cool, and some people in the audience began to snicker at him. "You will not snicker," Seth roared, and then ordered his security guard Jim to recap which kinds of laughter are not permitted in the studio. "No snickering, no chortling, and no tittering," said Jim. At the mention of the word tittering, Seth snickered and said, "Tittering." At this point, Seth became silent, sullen, and one might say melancholy, as he perhaps quietly came to terms with how his age actually made him feel. That his youth was indeed over, that life had gone by in an instant, that he'd never taken a sincere moment to fully enjoy, despite its complexities and hardships, all of life's true miraculous grandeur. He then burst out laughing and said, "Psych, I'm rich as hell, and my 20s sucked because I wasn't loaded to the teeth." He then asked Ben how many push-ups we were at, to which Ben replied, 28, to which Seth replied, "Keep going," to which Ben replied, "I'm doing a good job, right, Seth?" To which Seth replied, "Do you think you're doing a good job?" To which Ben, quoting Seth, said, "A good job's a done job." Seth then smiled to himself, but did not let Ben see. At this point, a witch appeared and said that if Seth really was okay with being 50, she would offer him a magical exchange she had concocted. Seth furtively looked around to see if anyone was watching, and even though everyone was, because it's a TV studio, he said, "I'm listening." She then offered him eternal youth for his firstborn son. "Sold," Seth said before she had even finished asking the question. The witch was actually kind of surprised. Most people need to mull it over a bit, but no matter. "For my second proposition, I require your secondborn..." "Sold," said Seth again. "You didn't even hear the offer yet," said the witch. "What's the offer?" he said. "Your supply of Titleist golf balls," said the witch. "Guess I've got a new hobby," said Seth with a big grin. The witch looked uncomfortable and turned to leave. "Wait a minute," said Seth. "What about the girl?" "Excuse me," said the witch. "My thirdborn, the girl. What can I get for her?" "Oh, I don't really think I have anything." "What do you got on ya?" "What do I have on me?" said the witch. "Half a pack of Big Red?" "Done," said Seth. They shook hands and an ominous light sealed their fate. Seth put a stick of the cinnamon gum in his mouth and laughed. It was clear he felt he won the bargain. The witch turned to leave, but for the first time in her wicked life, she felt a twinge of remorse. "Hey, maybe we just forget this whole thing," she began. But Seth couldn't hear her because he was on the phone with his son's school to inform them a different person will be doing pickup from now on. At this point, Ben was completing his push-ups. 48, 49, 50. "I did it," he said as he finished the feat of strength. The crowd erupted. They were truly inspired by Ben's display of youthful vigor. Several people threw roses. This made Seth jealous. Ben looked to Seth and said, "Did I make you proud today, boss?" Seth turned away from him. "You did okay," he said. For an orphan. NBC would like to ask viewers to disregard Seth's opinions, as they do not reflect the network's position and do not make any sense. We now resume our broadcast.
"And the only thing your 30 under list is good for is to wipe my ass. Woo! That felt good to get off my chest. We'll be right back with Paul Giamatti, everybody.